there were only a few that came over, so we're all related at some point.
Oh, all right. It's not like you get Jelly of the Month Club. It's just kind of like, if it's Smucker's, it's got to be good, kind of.
Right.
You just pull that on. It's your own tagline.
Exactly. Yeah. So it was only about 2 years ago in 2009 that I really, the end of 2009, that I started writing full time. Now, my time in Virginia, maybe the 2 or 3 years leading up to when I went full time writing, that's when I really started doing a lot. That's when I wrote my first two books while I still had my business down there. And so I was starting to get more and more leads, you know, people contacting me to help them write books. And that was sort of how I got into the industry, was through co-writing, ghostwriting, that sort of thing.
Yeah. And you continue to ghostwrite?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, most of the books that I've done to this point are co-written, excuse me, except for My Amish Roots, which is the one that just came out. And people are really intrigued at the idea of having such a consistent, strong heritage. I think these days people move around so much, as did my wife and I. You know, we moved all over the place. And I think to read a story that tells about a family that's been somewhere for, you know, basically the last 300 years, mm-hmm. Is really intriguing for people.
Yeah, absolutely. And you have, does your family still have connections with the Plain Amish?
Yeah, my all of my great aunts and great uncles, so my grandmother's brothers and sisters, probably 90% of them are still Amish. So I really grew up, you know, spending a lot of time with the Amish. It wasn't anything weird or strange to me. They were just, you know, part of the family, which is interesting. You know, I think a lot of people look at the Amish and they see all the things that they do, and they feel like it's such a negative, legalistic life. But a lot of them really enjoy it. A lot of them enjoy the tradition. You know, their parents, grandparents, great-grandparents have all done it. And there's a sense of security, a sense of belonging that comes with that. And so, yeah, it's a huge... Sure. It was a book that I wrote with my uncle. It was called Think No Evil. He's a counselor in the area, and he also grew up Amish. So he had kind of a unique outlook on everything that had happened. He knew some of the families who had lost children. And so within a year or two of the incident, he was approached to write a book about forgiveness. And it was really impactful for me. I had young kids at the time who were about the age of the youngest girl who was killed. And so it's, it was a powerful thing to be a part of. Mm-hmm. And it definitely challenged my views on forgiveness. And, you know, what I don't know, I think a lot of times we see certain things as unforgivable or things that we're not going to forget. And I learned a lot about forgiveness from my uncle while we wrote the book. Probably the main thing that comes to mind would be the idea that forgiveness doesn't mean forgetting. You know, we often talk about how forgiveness, you know, forgive and forget. But that was a big thing for me to realize that these hard things that happen to us in life, you'll never forget them. You know, you're going to remember them the rest of your life. Yeah. It's really how you choose to respond to them and how you choose to release those people from what they've done to you. It's really conditioned in them from a young age that if something tragic happens, it's not your job to make it right. It's not your job to necessarily bring the other person down because of what happened. So they're trained very early on to respond differently than maybe we are, you know, in the general public. It's pretty fascinating. I mean, and then a lot of people say, but how can, you know, you can't forgive that quickly. You know, within a couple of days, you're still experiencing pain and you're still hurting. How can you say you've forgiven them? And it was interesting because one of the Amish bishops in the area was asked that question a few days afterwards. They said, how can you forgive, you know, this has just happened so recently? And he said, well, you know, I forgive him today, and when I wake up tomorrow, I'll remember how much I hurt, and I'll forgive him again. And so, you start to see how it is not just a once and done, but it's really a process that you have to commit to entering into.
Yeah, I remember hearing.
I think one thing that we try and emphasize is having a good work ethic. And our two oldest kids are still only 8 and 7, but you know, we try and give them a lot of responsibility around the house. They started doing laundry this year, which is kind of a new thing for them. Mm-hmm. You know, we have a garden, so we get them out in the garden and you know, have them help us out there. I think I grew up working at farmers markets a lot. I worked for my grandmother, who was Amish at the time, who grew up Amish, and I felt like it was invaluable for me as I got older to have this foundation of being able to or being willing to work. And so that's something that we are trying to instill into our kids. There, another thing would be a real respect for the older generations. And I like that when we go to my parents' house, my grandmother is there, my kids get to see her, and they sort of start to get this appreciation for, you know, what the older generations have to offer, and also what they have to offer to her, in that, you know, as soon as they get there, they run to her side of the house, they're looking for candy. you know, they really love having her around, and so that's something that I would love for my kids to grow up with.
That's a great value.